So we see laboratory animals, livestock, and incidents of human disease. That's where we find the parallels. No human clinical trials on fertility with GMOs. Just an uncontrolled random experiment with the entire population of the Earth. Roundup is linked to birth defects. It is known to be linked to birth defects, and it's been discovered as early as the 80s, but the information was hidden. It also interferes with the production of aromatase, which is important for creation of estrogen. It also interferes with testosterone. It also creates fewer sperm and abnormal sperm in mice. So Roundup itself is known to cause reproductive disorders. When you spray Roundup on crops, it absorbs into the food portion of the crop, and then we eat it in very high concentrations. Now, Roundup also chelates minerals in the plant, making them unavailable to the plant, making them unavailable to the livestock that eat the plant. So we eat the livestock that have mineral deficiencies, we eat the plant that has mineral deficiencies, and we eat the Roundup, which then causes further mineral deficiencies, and certain minerals are important in reproduction. So manganese is important in reproduction. And manganese is not only chelated by Roundup, it's also reduced in the plants that are Roundup ready because the insertion of the gene creates some metabolic pathway that blocks the production of manganese. And manganese deficiency is practically universal in livestock in the United States. And manganese deficient animals are being born with birth defects or stillborn. So that's my first answer. Okay? You asked about reproduction. Has anyone changed their number yet in terms of how vigilant they want to be in avoiding GMOs? Raise your hand if your number has gotten higher. Just checking. So the 9 GM food crops, soy, corn, cotton, canola, sugar beets, alfalfa, Hawaiian papaya, little zucchini, little crookneck squash, yellow. That's it. Those are the only ones that are commercialized. No wheat, no rice. They're growing in field trials, but they're not serving to us. All right, so you asked about, what's your question again?
Thinking. How it affects the thinking of people.
Okay. I think that our institute may be the only organization that's now collecting experiences of people when they switch from GM to non-GM. And I've asked for health things, and I've gotten some attitude, behavior things. Not a lot. I haven't collected a lot of those. I know we just started. What we see in terms of thinking is we can track it in terms of behavior of animals. That's the best I can do in that work. Dr. Don Huber was speaking about the behavioral changes in animals, the changes in the gut bacteria, and the changes in the digestive tract in Germany last year. And a physician came up to him afterwards and said, these are the same problems that we're seeing in autistic children. And this physician was an expert in autism. He had studied his entire career. So let's focus not on the digestive problems, unless someone asks about that. We'll talk about digestive problems later. But someone else had a question about immunity first. But we'll get to the question next. Thank you for that. Nice idea.
Well, I think the digestion and the thinking are polar things that work with each other.
Yeah. Digestion, and it's like everyone knows, even if you're feeling kind of sick in the stomach, you're depressed and you're changing.
Exactly.
It's more than that. Because if you look at the studies that are done with the animals, very few look at behavior. But sometimes they find behavioral differences, even when they're not designing a study to look at. So first one I know about was Hintz Hagedorn from, I think that's how you spell this, pronounce his name, from Holland, did a study in his college undergraduate class where he took mice and found that the mice had a preference for the non-GM, which is almost universal among animals. Some completely avoid GM when given a choice, his didn't. But then when he force-fed one group non-GM and one group GM, soy and corn, when it went to weigh them, those which were fed to the GM were scared out of their minds. They went to pick them up and they'd run around, they'd be scared and they'd try and bite them. Completely different behavior than the group eating the non-GM. And then Humer tells him about, he visited an animal feeding study with rats, I believe. He said you can pick up the rats that are in the GM-fed group and treat them like pets and pet them and hold them. Those that are fed GM are aggressive and antisocial. They go off on their own. They don't interact with the others. A farmer in the Midwest changed his pigs from GM corn to non-GM corn, and the pigs were playing again, like they had 14 years earlier when he had non-GM corn as the usual feed. And for 14 years, his job became the hardest in the farm, running the nursery, because of all the disease and the behavior problems, and it had been the easiest. And he noticed that when he came to feed the pigs, after they switched to non-GM corn, they would continue to play after he left, but when he was feeding GM corn, they were so sickly or tired that before they left the facility, they were all lying down again. Irina Ermakova tested aggression between GM and non-GM fed rats and found the parents and the offspring were more aggressive and would bite and bite each other, etc. In a South African farm, when the pigs were fed GM corn, some would wander off like they had Alzheimer's, not know where the feed bin was and die, and others would be cannibalistic, biting off the ears and tails of the other pigs, until the pigs changed to non-GM corn, and then the behavior reverted. And then he ran out of non-GM corn, started feeding GM corn again, the behavior came back, and then he reverted back to non-GM corn when it had its growing season, and the behavior reverted back. So that's all I can tell you.
That's pretty telling.
Pretty telling. So the next was immune system function. All right. Every competent study that looked at immune system reactions has found it. Now, if we think about what is an immune system reaction, it's the body's reaction to something foreign which it interprets as a threat. By definition, GMOs have something foreign, and the body can react to that foreign substance. Now, one of the first immune system tests that were done was done on genetically engineered potatoes with rats. And Arpad Pusztai fed these potatoes to a group of rats that was engineered to produce an insecticide. He fed another group of rats non-GM potatoes, the third group non-GM potatoes, but their diet was spiked with the insecticide that the GM potatoes produced. You have GM, non-GM, non-GM plus insecticide. Only the group that ate the GM potatoes got sick. And among their problems, in addition to smaller testicles, smaller brains, smaller livers, partial atrophy of the liver, potentially precancerous cell growth in the digestive tract, which we'll talk about later in your excellent question. They also had a damaged immune system and also damage in the organs associated with immune response. So their immune system was slower and more sluggish. But what was the cause of the problems? It wasn't the insecticide, because the group over here had the insecticide, and the group over here was the one that got the reaction. It was the process of genetic engineering that caused the massive damage to the rats in just 10 minutes. So it's generic. Here's another immune problem. We're going to go for immune first. Mice fed genetically modified BT corn had massive immune system responses. IgE antibodies, IgA antibodies, cytokines, interleukin. It was just across the board, especially among the weaning mice and the elderly mice, where mice and humans are more at risk. Now, these animals were eating corn that had BT toxin in it. Now, BT toxin is claimed by Health Canada to have no interaction with human beings. And it's claimed to be destroyed during digestion and has a history of safe use in the food supply because it's in its natural soil bacterium form is used as an insecticide that breaks open the stomach of insects and kills them. However, all of those assumptions by Health Canada are false according to peer-reviewed published studies. Completely false, terribly false, maybe deadly false. When BT toxin was sprayed for gypsy moth infestation in Vancouver and Washington State, about 500 people reported allergic and flu-like symptoms, some had to go to the hospital. When farm workers mixed it up, the BT, and spilled it on themselves, many had immune system responses. When farm workers were tested in the United States, they found antibody responses associated with BT. So there was immune system triggering. Mice fed BT, triggered their immune system, and caused their immune system to start to react to formerly harmless foods. So it was causing a wider spectrum of immune system responses. And the BT in the crops is thousands of times more concentrated than the spray form. In India, thousands of farm workers are getting allergic and flu-like symptoms on their bodies and their respiratory systems from just touching the BT cotton, the same allergic and flu-like symptoms that the people in Vancouver reported when they were sprayed with BT. So the mice may be reacting to the BT, but when you engineer a genetically engineered crop, you cause massive collateral damage, and so genes can be switched on, switched off, increased, decreased. There happens to be a silent gene in corn that does not produce gamazine, which is a known allergen, but it does produce it in GM corn because it was switched on from the process of genetic engineering, so the mice may be reacting to the gamazine and the BT, we don't know. With soy, soon after GM soy was introduced to the UK, soy allergies skyrocketed by 50%. Soy, cooked soy, that's genetically modified, has as much as 7 times the amount of a known allergen called trypsin inhibitor than cooked non-GM soy. One study with a bad control, but it's still interesting, found a different new allergen in GM soy than wasn't in non-GM soy. The Roundup Ready protein produced in the soy, designed to be produced in the soy, designed to make the plant tolerant to Roundup, has properties of a dust mite allergen, which means that the soy fails the World Health Organization's criteria designed to minimize the likelihood that GMOs create allergens. But it was just a recommendation, not a requirement. Now that dust mite issue means if you're allergic to dust, you might be allergic to soy that's genetically modified. Soy can cross-react with peanut allergies. Soon after GM soy was introduced to the UK, peanut allergies doubled in 5 years, which might be GM soy related. In fact, it also might be related to the fact that when mice were fed GM soy, they had changes and damage to their pancreatic cells and a dramatic reduction in the digestive enzyme. If it takes longer for your pancreas to digest proteins, the enzymes created them, then it needs longer period for an allergic reaction. So eating GM soy might create an allergic reaction to a wide variety of foods. And there's more herbicide in the herbicide-tolerant crops, which in itself might provoke an allergic reaction, as well as its breakdown product, because when it goes into the plant, it has another product that's produced, so that might be an allergen.